if you would have asked me a couple months ago if there was any one band that I, you know, I had worked with or ever been around that would, that was going to reunite, I would not have said American Nightmare, Give Up the Ghost, whatever you want to call them. But one day this fall, it was a Friday late afternoon, early evening, I'm sitting at my kitchen table doing English homework with my 9.5-year-old daughter, and I got a phone call from a weird phone number that hadn't called me in a very long time. I let it go to voicemail, and it intrigued me so much what the message could possibly be. I couldn't take it, and I just fucking listened, and it was like, hey, it's Tim, Bomb, and Wes. You should call us back. I hope you're sitting down. And I was just like, get the fuck out of here. Like, so sure enough, you know, I called them back, and essentially, you know, Tim was just like, you know, we've been talking, and if you're in, we're in. And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, I needed him to say it. Like, I didn't want to assume what he was talking about. You know, and he's like, yeah, you know, I think we want to play some shows, and if you're down to do them, we'll do them. There was a moment at when they were rehearsing the night before. We sat there, we pulled up couches, and just sat there and watched them play. I was just like, holy shit, this is really going down. Like, and they're playing, and Wes is singing, and I'm just like, holy shit, this is for real.
Added to it, you know, grew bigger than them.
People were tired of music that was just soulless or just emulating other things or other genres or the subgenres that have existed, and they wanted something more, and they offered that.
Like Boston in the 90s was definitely a different time where it was very focused on straight edge and positive hardcore, you know, with bands like In My Eyes and Ten Year Fight. So to have a band that, you know, still played fast hardcore, but, you know, looked to, you know, more, I don't know, had more emotional and more, you know, darker lyrics, I think definitely helped them stand out.
We'll be right back. 1-2, 1-2, 1-2.
Check, check. Thanks.
You know, like when a band starts to like grow, or when a band starts to like blow up, or whatever you want to call it, you can see it happening. And you could see it happening with them. Like, they went from playing for like 150 kids in Maine, and then next thing you know, there's 800 people in Boston to see them when they put out their first record, you know?
You can ask anybody in Philadelphia. American Nightmare shows in Philly were not just your everyday show. It was very violent at times, unnecessarily, but like, you know, that band moved the city.
Check. Hi, we're American Nightmare. Thanks for being here.
Yeah.
It was real. It showed like a human gray area. The songs were emotional. They were poetic. They were passionate. Lyrics had more in common with prose than they did any sort of dime store rhyming that goes on in a lot of punk rock and hardcore. And I think at the time, generationally, there was something missing in the hardcore community. And they came and they filled that role. People were tired of music that was just soulless or just emulating other things or other genres or the subgenres that have existed, and they wanted something more, and they offered that, and it was just a really beautiful thing.
just want the world to know you've got me out of all the blue. What will not stop me? But I'm not a better boy. And I know my head with every deal. But it's still trying to be cold. And I can barely see. It's bumming him, it's him again. But are you alright with me? I was walking next to you. The thing is bad, it was good. And there was a word I'm not. And I was thinking it's a fucking you. And when the face is skin, it's what the face is, I quit. I can't believe you're not fucking dead. Never this, and that is that. And on my fucking head. I go, and I'm a relative. But seven stops, I get this gun. And I know that I was walking next to you. I was breathing next to fucking you. Any time you wanna go, I'm fucking ready. Ready to go, boy. No, I want a reason to smile before I'm dead. I'm dead. Sinners live, die of me, you sinners hoe. I'm falling down. I'm just a face. The fucking crap. My father's down and since the year is fucking over, my friend. I don't mean anything. I'm just a face, the fucking crowd.
Talk to me! I'm as damp as that! the thing about AN that's interesting is they were influencing hardcore bands, but they had more of an influence on bands that were like a step above hardcore. You know, like I think like a band like, say someone like AFI or something who was bigger than AN, but I feel like they kind of looked at AN as a guide or something. You know, I don't know that for sure, but I just, as a person who was around then, I'd look at it and I can just like put that together. I think a lot of people, you know, I think even a band like Converge, you know, I think they felt a huge connection with AN and it kind of just meshed. Like I remember when that tour happened, AN, Converge, Hope Conspiracy, it was almost like the whole show was just like one big movement of like something happening, you know.
I was telling my friend earlier, like if I could relive any show now, it would be that show, because at that time I was 18, still pretty new getting into hardcore, and that would be like, if I could say a show that solidified like realizing this is where I belong, that was that show. Because it was in like my first like 6 months of starting and kind of going to hardcore shows, kind of getting a vibe for the whole thing, and I had come across Converge and American Nightmare and bands like that. But that show was like, I did, like this is for me. Like that was time of their breakup, it was the time when metalcore was sort of like reigning over. Like I remember the last time I saw them was with like The Bled and Daughters or something like that. It was like a weird tour like that. So it was harder for bands doing what they were doing at that time to find tours that made sense. Like I saw them with Glassjaw one other time. Like things like that, you know? So at a time when they were doing what no one else was doing, it was harder for them to make it as a band. Sort of the same thing with like Refused, where it's like when Shapepoint to Come came out, that's not what anyone wanted to hear. But now, once they broke up, everybody was like, it's the best thing in the entire world. And I feel it's sort of similar with what happened with American Nightmare.
Like the breakup thing, that is what it is. You know, I was there, you know, let's just let that be. It's water under the bridge. You know, they were a real young band at the time and a lot of really crazy things were happening. And I'm not gonna speak on their behalf, you know. Some of those guys have been friends since high school and I'm glad that they were able to like sit and have an open forum of communication and just pull it back together, because again, imagine how special it is for those guys. You know, you see how special it is for kids, imagine how special it is for them to be up there, you know. And to me, that's an important thing.
Thanks for coming. I say thanks to Deathwish, FYF, Kim Moore, Matt, Bridge 9. We're gonna play two more.
Broken heart, the one is stereo. Thanks for spending the into your awful year with us. We're gonna play one more song. Thanks for being here. I say thanks to Sean and Matt Pike and Flav and Lucid, Touchstone, Shaping My Face.